I am second year resident from Punjab Institute of Cardiology, Lahore. Today my topic of discussion is serious anatomy and physiology. As we all know that the circulatory system is composed of heart, blood vessels and blood, and today our main concern would be the heart and a little bit the blood vessels. We all know that main function of the heart is to provide the oxygen and nutrient to the tissues and to carry away the products of metabolism. There are two systems which are running sidewise in the heart. They are low pressure pulmonary circulation and the high pressure systemic circulation. We will talk this, and first of all, we have a look of the cardiovascular anatomy. Heart is composed of four chambers, the right system and the left system. The right atrium and the right ventricle are separated by the tricuspid valve, and the left atrium and the ventricles are separated by the mitral valve. There are two more valves, which are the aortic valve and the pulmonary valve, which are pulmonary circulation. And then we have the cardiovascular anatomy. We know that the weight of the heart is about, of an adult heart, is about 200 gram to 400 gram. And there are some facts that about time 3.5 per billion time in a normal lifetime period, and each day heart beats about 100,000 times, and pumping capacity of the heart is about 7,750. Now we'll talk about the conductive pathway in the heart. We know that there is a specific conduction pathway in the heart in response to which the heart contracts. First of all, SA node, the action potential is generated in the SA node, and from there it is conducted to the AV node. SA node is located on the right atrium, and AV node is on the junction of the right and the atria and the ventricles. And from the action potential move from the SA node to the AV node, then we have the Purkinje system and bundle of His, and then this action potential travels through from also this action potential heart contract simultaneously. Now we talk about the innervation of the heart. Heart is have the both parasympathetic fibers basically innervate the atria and the conductive tissue, and acetylcholine on the specific cardiac muscarinic receptor M2 to produce the negative effect. Means इनके response में सारे negative effects आएंगे. Sympathetic fibers जो हैं, they are more widely distributed throughout the heart, and the cardiac sympathetic fibers, they mainly originate in the thoracic spinal cord from the level of T1 to T4 and travel to the heart initially through the cervical ganglia, and then from the ganglia as the cardiac node. Now have a look at the coronary circulation. Being an aesthetic, we are more concerned about knowing the coronary circulation, because we are dealing with the heart rate, basic cardiovascular physiology, because actually our main concern is the demand and supply. And that's why when heart is compromised during, for example, if some wall of the heart is compromised, during ischemia or MI, we have to know about the exact blood supply of the heart, so we have a clue that how much heart is compromised. So heart is coronary circulation. We know that that coronary circulation, coronary arteries, they are directly origin. We have right coronary artery and the left coronary artery. The right coronary artery, after origin from the aorta, it supplies the right atrium and most of the right ventricle, and a variable portion of the left ventricle inferior wall. And 85% in 85% of the person, the right ascending artery, which supplies the superior posterior interventricular septum and the inferior wall. Now, left coronary artery. The left coronary artery normally supplies the left atrium, most of the interventricular septum, and left ventricle. Septal wall, inferior wall, and the lateral wall. After a short course, the left main coronary artery, it bifurcates into the LAD, left anterior descending, and the left circumflex artery. Then LAD supplies the septal and the anterior walls, and the circumflex supplies the lateral wall. Here it is the dramatic diagram, and we can see that the red one is the left coronary artery and its branches, the purple one is the right coronary artery and its branches. And here is the numbering of the branches as well. Right coronary artery branches, you can see number one, right conus artery, number two, SA nodal artery, and number three, a right marginal branch, fourth one, posterior descending artery, and fifth one is the marginal and the terminal branch. Here the left coronary artery branches, anterior LAD, second phase circumflex, left marginal, and the diagonal branches of the LAD. Now, SC node is supplied by the right coronary artery, coronary artery, 60% of the individual. And in remaining 40% individual, it is supplied by the LAD. And AV node, it is usually supplied by the right coronary artery, but less frequently by the circumflex artery. The bundle of His has a dual blood supply drive both from the PDA and LAD, posterior descending artery and left anterior descending artery. Here, also another diagram, you can see the different branches and their name, and this is just diagrammatic representation of the diagram. And venous drainage of the heart is by the coronary sinus. The veins travel along with the arteries, and finally they open into the coronary sinus, and coronary sinus open into the right atrium. One thing which is more important to know about, hello, can you hear me, sir?
Yes. जी डॉक्टर तैयबा कंटिन्यू रखें, आ रही है आवाज आपकी.
ठीक है. Important thing which is coronary perfusion, it is except all other tissues, heart is supplied during the diastole, because during the systole, when heart muscle contract, the vessels which traverse to the myocardium, due to the contraction of the myocardium, these vessels are occluded. These vessels are occluded. But during diastole, when the pressure is of the myocardium is reduced or decreased, these vessels open and then supply the heart muscle. This is an important thing to know, that heart supply is during the diastole. That this concept is used during the intravascular during the balloon pump, intra-aortic balloon pump, which supplies the during the diastole, it supplies the heart. There are some factors. The myocardial oxygen supply demand, when the heart rate is increased, diastole filling time is decreased, and ejection fraction is decreased, and coronary perfusion pressure, aortic diastolic pressure, ventricular and diastolic, these are all factors you can see that they compromise the supply. And demand, whenever the vasomotor requirements are increased, heart rate is increased, then the demand of the heart is increased. Now, come towards the action potential of the heart. Action potential of the heart is somewhat different as compared to the skeletal muscle, because here the role of calcium is more as compared to the sodium. And sodium is as well important, but calcium is important here. Normally, the cell membrane of the heart is leaky to the, or permeable to the potassium, but impermeable to the sodium. And there are sodium potassium ATPase pumps, and resting membrane potential, all of you must be know, have the knowledge of about the resting membrane potential. The resting membrane potential of the heart is minus 90. During this phase, आउटसाइड ऑफ द मेम्ब्रेन इज मोर पॉजिटिव एज कम्पेयर टू द इनसाइड ऑफ द मेम्ब्रेन और इंट्रासेलुलर एनवायरनमेंट. सो सोडियम इज मोर आउटसाइड द सेल एंड पोटेशियम इज मोर इनसाइड द सेल. दिस इज द नॉर्मल रेस्टिंग मेम्ब्रेन पोटेंशियल स्टेट. वेन एवर द करंट कम थ्रेशोल्ड रीच एंड द रिवर्स एक्शन अकर्स ड्यूरिंग दिस फेज द सोडियम पंप sodium channels open and the sodium move rush into the cell and it convert the inside more positive and the action potential from minus 90 to 1 plus 110 to 120 plus 10 to 20 it can reach up to that. And here we see the action potential, that how the action potential is initiated. There are some phases, phase 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. The heart action potential is different in that sense that there is, we see the plateau form, which is not observed in normal skeleton muscles. During the resting membrane potential, minus 90 millivolt is the potential. In response to the stimulus, there is the rapid depolarization. Sodium channels open. I see you the this table. Here the channel wise we can see which channel will open and what event will happen. At zero phase, this upward stroke is the zero phase. This partial repolarization phase is the one. Slow repolarization is the phase two, and this rapid repolarization is the phase three. And again, resting phase is the phase four. Now, during phase one, an upstroke occurs. How? Activation of the voltage-gated sodium channels. They activate and they allow the sodium to come inward, and the cellular and movement sodium entry and decrease permeability to the potassium. During this phase, sodium enters inside and no permeability to potassium. During phase one, only rapid repolarization. What happens? Inactivation of the sodium channels. So transient change the sodium channels, it inactivates, and transient increase in the potassium permeability. Potassium start coming outside. In response to the action potential, sodium inside become more positive, and now potassium start coming out, and it is trying to. It is trying to convert the resting potential towards the resting membrane potential. During plateau phase, there is activation of the slow calcium channels. What happens? Calcium start entering inside, becoming the inside more positive. And finally, repolarization phase three. In this phase, inactivation of the calcium channels as well, and increased permeability to potassium. Potassium start to come out. And during phase four, resting potential is regained, normal permeability restored, sodium potassium ATP pump is active, and it in response to this, sodium is pumped outside the cell. Now, one thing more, which is how heart is continuously pumping, an action potential come and it is. Contracting the heart, and there is actually in the SA node there is a phenomenon of automaticity. And in the SA node there are special channels, HCN channels. They are actually these channels allow the slow influx of sodium, and due to this influx of the sodium, we know normal resting potential is the minus 90 millivolt, but due to slow influx of sodium, inside start becoming less negative, and the threshold and the resting membrane potential reaches up to minus 50 to minus 60. At this stage, whenever a little stimulus comes, a threshold comes, it starts new action potential. This is called the automaticity. Due to this automaticity, one another action potential occurs. Now, cardiac muscles have different anatomy. They are striated and they are contractile protein. Their contraction achieved through the release of calcium. Means after action potential, contraction of the muscle occur in response to release of the calcium, and there is excitation, contraction, coupling, and contraction occur. The simultaneous contraction of the ventricle occur. These muscles are rich in mitochondria, and there is aerobic dependent. They are aerobic dependent fibers connected to each other through the interrelated disc. Now, talk about the cardiac cycle. The cardiac cycle, there are the four five phases of the cardiac cycle. Number one is atrial systole. Second one is isometric contraction. Third one is the ejection. Fourth one, isometric relaxation. And fifth one is the filling. During atrial systole, the atria, mitral valve, and the tricuspid valve open. The atria puts its blood into the ventricle. After the 70% filling, the atria contract and contribute to about 20% in the filling of the ventricle. And this is the phase one, atrial systole. And second one is the isovolumetric contraction. During this phase, the mitral valve and the tricuspid valve closes. The pulmonary as well as the aortic valve are also closed. There is no further increase in the volume of the ventricle. And during this phase, the muscles start to contract. This is called the isovolumetric contraction. In response to this contraction, the ventricles build up enough pressure to eject blood into the aorta and into the pulmonary arteries. And third phase is the ejection. And during this phase, aortic and the pulmonary valve open and they eject blood into the aorta and the pulmonary valve respectively. And fourth phase is the isovolumetric relaxation. During this phase, the pulmonary and the aortic valve again closes and mitral and the tricuspid valve also close. During this, their ventricles start relaxation. Start relaxing, and the fifth one is the filling. Again, after relaxation, the filling of the ventricle start, the mitral valve open, and the mitral and the tricuspid valve open, and they put their blood into the ventricles. This is the cardiac cycle diagrammatic representation. Ventricle pressure, how the ventricle pressure build up during these phases. During diastole, there is the ventricle pressure is 10 millimeter of mercury, and during systole, it is meter. It is raised up to 1 to at end the. Atrial pressure. The pressure. हेलो
डॉक्टर तैयबा, दोबारा करें स्क्रीन शेयर।
जी सर।
जी अब ठीक है, अब दोबारा करें।
जी कहाँ कहाँ तक देखा?
ये कार्डिक, हाँ जी, कार्डिक साइकिल।
कार्डिक साइकिल
जी जी
सर, ठीक है। जी here is the atrial pressure changes during the cardiac pressure, the cardiac cycle, and Here the aortic pressure changes. At the start of systole, the aortic pressure is 90 millimeter of mercury, and at the peak of the systole, it reaches up to 120 millimeter of mercury, and again it reaches to the base level at diastole at the 90 millimeter of mercury. In response to action potential, we already have talked about that there is the contraction of the muscle, and it is a diagram which can show that after acetylcholine release of acetylcholine at the motor end plate, there is the initiation of the action potential, and sodium comes inside, and action potential is forwarding towards the TW, and in response to this action potential, also there is opening of the calcium channels, and calcium is also released from the sarcoplasmic reticulum. This intracellular increase in the calcium, this calcium is attached to the troponin contractile proteins, which are present in the heart. These are actin and myosin, and the troponin and tropomyosin. This calcium is attached to the troponin, and it allows the binding of the actin and myosin. And in response to release of calcium, the binding of the actin and myosin occur, and they start contracting. This is the mechanism of contraction and excitation contraction coupling. Now we talk about the cardiac output. Cardiac output is the sum of heart rate and stroke volume. And we know that if the stroke volume is kept constant, cardiac output will totally depend upon the heart rate. And at rest, when no one is doing exercise and other some activity, cardiac output is almost 4900 ml per minute or 5 liter per minute. Because during each contraction, heart almost ejects 17 ml of the blood. And here the important formulas of the CVS, which is the pulse pressure. We all know the pulse pressure is the difference between the systolic blood pressure and the diastolic blood pressure. And the mean arterial pressure is that diastolic pressure plus 1/3 of the pulse pressure. Yeah, इसे एक दूसरे तरीके से भी हम देख सकते हैं कि it is the sum of diastolic pressure, systolic pressure plus 2 into diastolic pressure divided by 3. इसको इस तरीके से भी कैलकुलेट कर सकते हैं. कार्डियक आउटपुट इज इन द प्रीवियस स्लाइड वी हैव सी दैट हार्ट रेट इनटू स्ट्रोक वॉल्यूम एंड ब्लड प्रेशर फार्मूला इज द कार्डियक आउटपुट इनटू द सिस्टेमिक वास्कुलर रेजिस्टेंस एंड सिस्टेमिक वास्कुलर रेजिस्टेंस इट इज कैलकुलेटेड बाय द मेन आर्टेरियल प्रेशर जैसा कि हमने ऊपर देखा माइनस सीवीपी डिवाइडेड बाय कार्डियक आउटपुट इनटू एटी. And it is systemic vascular resistance. It is taken in the dynes, and it is normally 150 almost 900 to 1500 dynes systemic vascular resistance. And pulmonary vascular resistance is calculated by the mean pulmonary artery pressure minus mean pulmonary wedge pressure. Actually, यहाँ पे left atrial pressure mean pulmonary artery pressure minus left atrial pressure, but we calculate the left atrial pressure by the mean pulmonary wedge pressure, so it is also used pulmonary wedge pressure divided by cardiac output divided into 80, and it is normally 50 to 150 dynes. Cardiac index, it is calculated by the cardiac output divided by body surface area. And body surface area, it is dependent upon the weight and height of the person. And body surface area, if someone is interested in calculating body surface area, it is the weight into height divided by 3600 under root. Okay, now determinants of the ventricular performance. When we talk about the ventricular performance, we normally talk about the it means that we are talking about the left ventricle. The determinants of left ventricular performance are are the heart rate and the stroke volume. And we know that stroke volume is the volume from per contraction. And stroke volume will depend upon the preload, afterload, contractility, warm motion abnormalities, and the valvular dysfunction. We now explain what are the preload, afterload, and contractility. And preload, it was first described by the Starling law. That Starling law is that what increase in the force of contraction as resting length of cardiac muscle increase. For example, in response to the feeling, the cardiac muscle stretch and how much stretch before contraction. If there is increase in the stress, increase in the cardiac output. Increasing stroke volume as volume of ventricle immediately before contraction was increased. This was described by the Starling, it is called the Starling law. And intrinsic control of the cardiac output is by preload and afterload and contractility. Preload refers to the level of stretch in a relaxed muscle just before it contracts. Level of stretch in a relaxed muscle just before it contracts. In the heart, this is largely dictated by the venous return. So increase venous return, increase in the stretch and, in the muscle, which increase in the cardiac output. And afterload refers to the force against which the muscle must generate, against which the heart have, is the force against which heart has to deliver, refers to a force that the muscle must generate during contraction, most affected by the change in the arterial pressures. And contractility, it is the rate of myocardial muscle shortening, and it depends on the intracellular calcium concentration. हेलो
जी जी
डिस्कनेक्ट हो गया
सही सुन रहे हैं जहां पे डिस्कनेक्ट होगा आपको बताएंगे
इंट्रिंसिक कंट्रोल ऑफ द कार्डियक आउटपुट ओके कार्डियक आउटपुट इज कंट्रोल्ड बाय द एक्सट्रिंसिक फैक्टर्स फॉर एग्जांपल नर्वस कंट्रोल सिंपैथेटिक एंड पैरासिंपैथेटिक Sympathetic, it is controlled in the number of regions of the CNS. Postganglionic nerves release the neurotransmitter noradrenaline. Stimulation of the nerve leads to increased heart rate, positive chronotropic effect, increased myocardial contractility, positive inotropic effect, leads to increased cardiac output at any given pressure. Limits to benefit of increased heart rate due to the compromised atrial filling. Extrinsic control of the cardiac output, parasympathetic control. It comes from the medulla oblongata in the brain and reach heart via the vagus nerve. Supply ST node and AV node, we already have talked about this, and release acetylcholine and stimulatory. This slows heart rate, negative chronotropic effect through its influence on the pacemaker activity and reduction in the cardiac activity. Heart has also the hormonal control, catecholamines, adrenaline and noradrenaline. These are released by the adrenal medulla in response to the sympathetic nervous system stimulation. These adrenaline and noradrenaline, again, they increase both the heart rate and the myocardial contraction. Now come towards the systemic circulation. We know that systemic circulation comprises of arteries, arterioles, capillaries and veins. And as all other systems have the mechanism of autoregulation, circulatory system also have the mechanism of autoregulation. And the myocardium regulates its blood supply between the perfusion pressure of 50 and 120 millimeter of mercury. Beyond this range, blood flow becomes increasingly pressure dependent. Arterial pressure. You know, cardiac output is the sum of arterial pressure into the resistance, and arterial pressure, changing pressure difference across this vascular bed, and it is changing its vascular resistance. So there are only two ways in which we can affect the blood flow by increasing the arterial pressure or by decreasing the resistance. You know, if cardiac output is constant, then pressure difference between two points will be proportional to the resistance. Pressure in aorta and large artery is high and pulsatile, and there is only a small drop in the pressure longer than. Largest pressure drops occur in the arterioles, so single largest contribution to the peripheral resistance comes from the arteriole. Therefore, peripheral resistance can be controlled by constriction or dilatation of these arterioles. Again, these cases are also regulated by the nervous control. There is vasomotor center. Vasomotor center activates the parasympathetic nerves, stimulates heart rate and contractility, release noradrenaline, causes venules to constrict, which increases the venous return. Increasing the cardiac output. Preganglionic sympathetic nerve stimulates release of the adrenaline and noradrenaline from the adrenal medulla. Baroreceptor reflex. We know that stretch receptors in the carotid sinus and aortic arch, they are present, and whenever there is increasing the arterial pressure, they stretch upon aorta and the carotid sinus, the carotid arteries. These stimulate the sensory output from the receptors, and which inhibit the sympathetic outflow to the cardiovascular system. And in response, stimulates the parasympathetic nerve supply, thereby reducing the cardiac output and respond very rapidly. It means whenever there is increase in the arterial pressure, it is regulated by the baroreceptor reflexes, which are present in the carotid sinus and aortic arch. Low pressure, in reverse, it occurs in the low pressure states. Low pressure volume receptor reflexes in all of the great veins, atria and the pulmonary trunk, particularly sensitive to the changes in the blood volume. Increased blood volume stretches these receptors, which reduces the blood pressure by reducing the vasoconstrictor sympathetic activity and reducing the resistance. And release of ADH is also inhibited. ADH causes direct vasoconstriction and stimulates the water absorption from the kidney. Chemoreceptors found in the aortic and carotid bodies, these are sensitive to the changes in the tissue oxygen level. So if arterial pressure is very low, oxygen levels may drop at the tissue level. This stimulates the vasoconstriction vasoconstrictor sympathetic nerves to restore the blood pressure. Catecholamine, again, adrenaline, noradrenaline, and ADH, and renin-angiotensin system, they also regulate the blood pressure. So all these systems, sympathetic, parasympathetic, the renin-angiotensin, the hormonal control, they regulate the blood pressure, and according to the physiological demands, they regulate the blood pressure. Now, for the ideal situation, the requirement for the effective operation, contraction of the cardiac muscle must occur at the regular interval and be synchronized. These are our aims which we have to achieve. And valve must be fully open, not stenotic, valve must not be leaky, muscle contraction must be forceful, ventricle muscle fill adequately during diastole. And as the point of view, anesthetic point of view, we have to be conscious about these parameters, so we can regulate the exact physiology of the heart. Thank you very much. Dr.
Taiba, thank you so much.
It was a very big topic. I try to cover it all.
जी मैं ये थोड़ा सा लंबा टॉपिक था तो बहरहाल आपने अच्छी कोशिश की है. That's good. अब किसी के जहन में कोई क्वेश्चन हो, कोई चीज ऐड करना चाहे, हैंड रेज का ऑप्शन यूज करें या चैट में लिख दें। जी सर, अनम्यूट करें अपने तरफ।
अस्सलाम वालेकुम।
जी सलाम सर, कैसे हैं?
अल्हम्दुलिल्लाह, अल्लाह का शुक्र है। डॉक्टर तैयबा, एक्सीलेंट प्रेजेंटेशन, अ वेरी लार्ज टॉपिक बट यू कवर्ड नाइसली। इट वाज अ वेरी नाइस प्रेजेंटेशन एंड जस्ट वन कमेंट। द फार्मूलाज, दीज फार्मूलाज आर आस्क्ड इन द एमसीक्यूज। You have to calculate the values and then the correct value is in the options. So you must practice these formulas with the normal values so that you can quickly calculate and reach to the correct answer in the MCQ. You have covered the formulas. One formula is missing in this. And I also missed. I shared these formulas in the WhatsApp group. But one formula I miss is the calculation of the ejection fraction. This is also asked in some MCQs, and the formula is that I will also share in the group. The formula is end diastolic volume minus end systolic volume divided by diastolic volume multiplied by 100. So ejection fraction is also important. And whenever you are assessing the patient for any operation, patients of CCF or any other cardiac disease, you look for the ejection fraction. And ejection fraction may be normal, but the patient's function may be compromised. When both the end diastolic volume and end systolic volume both are decreased, the ejection fraction will be normal. So you have to clinically correlate the ejection fraction, because the ejection fraction may be falsely normal because of the both values being in the norm, in the both values are decreased. So very nice presentation. A slight correlation should have been with the electrocardiogram. I think we did not. It's a separate topic. And inshallah, I would like to cover this topic, electrocardiogram, in one day. I will inshallah volunteer for ECG, and I will give this presentation on this forum, inshallah. Maybe next or next week or the week after next, inshallah.
Okay. जी जरूर जरूर सर, इसमें इंशाल्लाह ले लेंगे आपको next में, इसी जो मॉड्यूल चल रहा है इसी में ले लेंगे आप. Anyone else want to add or ask question?
Thank you, sir.
और किसी का कोई सवाल या कोई ऐड करना चाहे? अभी 13 मिनट पड़े हैं 12 बजने में। जी डॉक्टर वसीमा, आप अनम्यूट किया।
अस्सलाम वालेकुम।
जी करें बात।
स्टार्लिंग लॉ एक्सप्लेन कर दें, वो समझ नहीं आ रहा।
जी
अस्सलाम
जी
वालेकुम सर। सर
जी
स्टार्लिंग लॉ समझ नहीं आ रहा, वो एक्सप्लेन कर दें।
जी बिल्कुल जी, डॉक्टर तैयबा करेंगे आप एक्सप्लेन।
हाँ जी, कैन यू हियर मी?
जी जी करें बात।
जी सर, एक्चुअली स्टार्लिंग लॉ इन सिंपल वर्ड इस तरह से हम समझ सकते हैं कि व्हेनेवर द फिलिंग ऑफ द वेंट्रिकल स्टार्ट्स, द वेंट्रिकल दे द मसल ऑफ द वेंट्रिकल दे स्टार्ट स्ट्रेच इन रिस्पॉन्स टू द फिलिंग टू अकोमोडेट द ब्लड, एंड इफ greater filling or the increase in the venous return, the much is the much is the stretch of the muscles. And Starling law is that how much the stress of the muscle stretch of the muscle before the how much the greater the stretch of the muscle in response to filling, greater will be the force of contraction it will eject the blood, by which it will eject the blood. I think you can understand what I am trying to say. It is called the Starling law.
थैंक यू डॉक्टर साहबा। इसमें सिंपल ये है कि आप ना इसको स्प्रिंग को जेन में रखें तो आपको समझ आ जाएगा कि स्प्रिंग को जितना आप खींचेंगे उतनी ताकत से वो वापस आएगा। तो ऐसे ही जो मसल है कार्डिक मसल, वो जितने स्ट्रेच होंगे उतनी ही फोर्सफुली वो कॉन्ट्रैक्ट करेंगे। अब उनको स्ट्रेच करने के लिए जो फोर्स यूज होती है वो प्री लोड है, तो जितना उसको वॉल्यूम रिवर्स होकर हार्ट में आएगा रिसीव होगा उतने ज्यादा मसल स्ट्रेच होंगे और उतने ही वो ज्यादा फोर्सफुली कॉन्ट्रैक्ट करेंगे, बट अप टू सर्टन लिमिट। कि अगर उस लिमिट को क्रॉस कर जाएंगे तो वो फिर फ्लैसिड हो जाते हैं। सेम एज स्प्रिंग, आप स्प्रिंग को एक लिमिट से ज्यादा खींच दें तो फिर वो अपना फंक्शन लूज कर जाता है, वो वापस नहीं आता। तो ऐसे ही कार्डिक मसल भी जो है ना, एक सर्टन लिमिट तक आप उसको स्ट्रेच करेंगे तो फोर्सफुली वापस आएंगे, अगर उस लिमिट को क्रॉस कर जाएंगे तो फिर वो फ्लैसिड हो। जी डॉक्टर साकिब।
डॉक्टर वसीमा, आप इसको इस तरह समझ सकती हैं जैसे हाथ है ना, हाथ को अगर आपने स्ट्रेच करना है तो हाथ में अगर आप किसी को बताते हैं कि हाथ की एक्सरसाइजेस करो तो आप उसको एक सॉफ्ट बॉल हाथ में पकड़ा देते हैं, उसको कहते हैं कि इसको प्रेस करो। अगर आप बॉल के बगैर उसको जोर लगाने की कोशिश करेंगे तो हाथ में फोर्स पैदा नहीं होती है। जितना हार्ट जो है वो फिल होगा उतना उसके अंदर फोर्स ज्यादा प्रोड्यूस होगी। जितना हार्ट फिल होगा उतना उसके जो मसल्स हैं वो ज्यादा फोर्सफुली कंट्रैक्ट करेंगे। अगर वो फिल नहीं होगा तो खाली हार्ट जो है वो फोर्स नहीं प्रोड्यूस करता। जितना हार्ट स्ट्रेच होगा वॉल्यूम के साथ उतना, जैसे आप हाथ है ना, हाथ को ऐसे खोल लें तो उसको वापस लेके आए तो ज्यादा जोर से, और अगर हाथ छोटा हुआ मतलब आप उसको खोलें नहीं और उसको स्ट्रेच करने की कोशिश करें, उसको कंट्रैक्ट करने की कोशिश करें तो इतनी फोर्स प्रोड्यूस नहीं होती है। जितना हाथ को ज्यादा खोल के उसको दूर से लेके आएंगे तो ज्यादा फोर्स प्रोड्यूस होती है। बिल्कुल इसी तरह से जितना हार्ट ज्यादा फिल होता है उतना उसके जो फाइबर्स हैं उसके अंदर कंट्रैक्टाइल फोर्स ज्यादा प्रोड्यूस होती है। दिस इज स्टार्लिंग लॉ। यानी अगर हार्ट सही तरह और अगेंस्ट अ प्रेशर फिल होता है तो वो ज्यादा जोर से उसके मसल जो है वो फाइबर ज्यादा फोर्सफुली कंट्रैक्ट करते हैं और ज्यादा से स्टार्लिंग ला। और अगर इसी में इसी वजह से जो है वो खाली जो हार्ट है, जैसे जब एम्बोलिज्म होता है, एयर एम्बोलिज्म में हार्ट जो है वो उसमें फोर्स नहीं प्रोड्यूस होती, वॉल्यूम नहीं फिल होता, अंदर सारी झाग बन जाती है, झाग बन जाती है तो हार्ट जो है ना नहीं प्रोड्यूस होती, हार्ट फेल्स। तो ये स्टार्लिंग लॉ है, उसके अकॉर्डिंग टू स्टार्लिंग लॉ नो फोर्स विल बी प्रोड्यूस इन द हार्ट मसल्स, इसीलिए जो है वो जब भी जो है हम वॉल्यूम को फिल इन करेंगे तो ब्लड प्रेशर प्रोड्यूस होगा। तो ये भी है हार्ट की जो फिजियोलॉजी है उसके अंदर है कि उसको वॉल्यूम जो है इट इज इम्पोर्टेंट फॉर।
बिल्कुल अच्छा, ये दो क्वेश्चन आए हैं। एक है व्हाट इज डिफरेंस वेदर सिस्टोलिक हार्ट फेलियर एंड डायस्टोलिक हार्ट फेलियर इज डिफरेंट, तो डेफिनेटली डिफरेंट है। इसमें एटोमिसिटी की एक्सप्लेनेशन पे बात की है कि डॉक्टर तैयबा से रिक्वेस्ट करते हैं एटोमिसिटी को थोड़ा एक्सप्लेन कर दें।
हाँ जी सर, ऑटोमिसिटी को इस तरह से समझ लें कि ऐसे नोड है जो उसके अंदर एक स्पेशल किस्म के रिसेप्टर्स होते हैं, HCN रिसेप्टर्स जो उसने उसने बात की थी। जो HCN रिसेप्टर हैं उनकी ये प्रॉपर्टी है कि वो सोडियम को अलाउ करते हैं कि वो स्लोली स्लोली इससे इंट्रासेलुलरली आते रहें। तो जैसे हमने पहले पढ़ा कि रेस्टिंग मेम्ब्रेन पोटेंशियल ऑफ हार्ट इज -19 mV, लेकिन चूंकि ये स्लो मूवमेंट ऑफ सोडियम जो कि इनवर्ड आता जा रहा है, इसकी वजह से इनसाइड ऑफ द सोडियम इज बिकमिंग लेस नेगेटिव एंड इन रिस्पॉन्स टू दिस द रेस्टिंग मेम्ब्रेन पोटेंशियल इज फ्रॉम -90 इट फॉल्स अप टू -50 और -60 mV। And -50 or -60, it is very near to the threshold level.
जी ठीक हो गया।
Single stimulus comes, the threshold is achieved and action potential will start. It is called the atomicity. यानी automatically उसके एक नया generate होता जाता है, अगला action potential लाता जाता है। इसको
सही हो गया। और क्वेश्चन जी? सिस्टोलिक हार्ट फेलियर और डायस्टोलिक हार्ट फेलियर डिफरेंस, एनीवन वांट टू आस्क ऐड समथिंग अबाउट दिस डिफरेंस ऑफ सिस्टोलिक एंड डायस्टोलिक हार्ट फेलियर? इसमें देखें जो सिस्टोलिक हार्ट फेलियर है दैट इज एक्चुअली द फेलियर ऑफ कॉन्ट्रैक्शन एंड डायस्टोलिक हार्ट फेलियर इज ए फेलियर ऑफ रिलैक्सेशन। तो सिस्टोलिक हार्ट फेलियर में कॉन्ट्रैक्शन की वजह से जो आगे पुश करेगा स्ट्रोक वॉल्यूम वो कम होगा, और जो डायस्टोलिक हार्ट फेलियर है उसमें जो है वो स्टिफ होते हैं मसल, कार्डिक मसल, वो रिसीव कम करते हैं वॉल्यूम ऑफ ब्लड, तो अल्टीमेटली जब वो कॉन्ट्रैक्ट करेंगे तो उससे भी स्ट्रोक वॉल्यूम कम हो जाएगा। तो ये एक मोटा डिफरेंस है जिसको आप फर्दर डिटेल में पढ़ेंगे तो और समझ में आ जाएगा। मोटी बात यही है कि कॉन्ट्रैक्शन फेलियर इज सिस्टोलिक हार्ट फेलियर एंड रिलैक्सेशन फेलियर इज डायस्टोलिक हार्ट फेलियर। जी डॉक्टर तैयबा, आप कुछ ऐड करना चाहें इस पे?
सर एक्चुअली मैंने फिजियोलॉजी पे ज्यादा फोकस किया था, ये पैथोलॉजी से रिलेटेड थोड़ा टॉपिक था, ऑल्दो ये मॉडर्न में इसके साथ ही उन्होंने डिस्कस किया है, लेकिन मैंने इसे इन डिटेल अभी नहीं पढ़ा। मेरे ख्याल से सीनियर जल्दी कमेंट कर दीजिए ज्यादा बेहतर।
ठीक है, ओके, इस पे फिर वाइंड अप करें। मेरे ख्याल में किसी का और क्वेश्चन नहीं है तो इसकी मैं वीडियो जो वो अपलोड कर दूंगा और लोग भी इसको देख सकेंगे। और नेक्स्ट वीक में हमारा जो टॉपिक फॉर स्टडी एंड डिस्कशन होगा वो कार्डियोवास्कुलर मॉनिटरिंग है, तो उस पर डॉक्टर हिना आई थिंक उन्होंने पहले से ही इस पर कमिटमेंट की हुई है कि वो बनाना चाहती हैं, तो वो मेरे ख्याल में इस पर करेंगी। और इसमें आपके MCQs और FCQs सबमिशन वो पूरा प्रोसेस ज़रा 4 phases पे हमारा चलेगा, तो ये नेक्स्ट वीक का हमारा जो है वो टॉपिक है कार्डियोवास्कुलर मॉनिटरिंग। तो मीनवाइल हम ये अगले ही वीक में प्लान कर लेंगे फॉर प्रिपरेटरी कोर्स ऑफ IMM MSNSCDIA, और उसमें जो हमारे साथ टीचर हैं उनके लिए एक हम ओरिएंटेशन सेशन करेंगे एंड विद इन 2-3 days वो भी अनाउंस कर देंगे। तो जिन लोगों ने IMM का रिटर्न पास किया हुआ है उनको भी इंशाल्लाह हम एंगेज करेंगे, और उसमें कोशिश हमारी ये है कि 7 दिन का वो कोर्स होगा जिसमें हम डेली 1 से 2 जो यूनिट हैं जैसे कार्डियोवास्कुलर रेस्पिरेटरी, वो हम एक एक फैसिलिटेटर को दे देंगे, उसके ऊपर वो आपको मॉर्निंग टाइम में ही करेंगे तो उस पर वो ब्रीफ कर देंगे, फिर एंड पे हम आपकी रिहर्सल करवा देंगे जो एग्जाम से रिलेटेड है उसके पैटर्न पे। तो थैंक यू सो मच एंड सी यू नेक्स्ट फ्राइडे विद द टॉपिक ऑफ कार्डियोवास्कुलर मॉनिटरिंग।